Hi everyone. Today we're going to back out just a bit. We've been looking at photosynthesis and respiration. We're going to back out a bit though and try to look at the big picture. So today we're going to study energy and nutrients and ecosystems. We're going to look at how these things move in ecosystems. If you should need me, if you have questions, my email address is on the screen. That's absolutely the best way to get a hold of me. If you haven't already gotten your materials, I want you to pause the video and go find your science notebook, a pencil, and some color pencils. Let's look at today's objectives. Okay, by the end of today's Excuse me, by the end of today's lesson, you should be able to explain the life process of nutrition. Now, I know that we've taken a brief look at this in the last video. I mentioned it, but I need you to be able to do this by the end of the video. I need you to be able to list the three energy roles in an ecosystem and describe how each of the organisms that share this energy role get their nutrition. This is something that you studied in fifth, probably even seen it in grades before that, but we'll do a quick review. I need you to list the three basic types of consumers and be able to tell me what they mostly eat. I need you to be able to explain how energy moves through an ecosystem and how it is lost. Notice that is in parentheses. Explain how nutrients move through an ecosystem and how they are recycled. All right, so here we go. So remember, life processes, when we talk about those, we're talking about those essential activities carried out by all living things. And I keep trying to refer you back to this drawing of Mrs. Green. And remember, all living things have to engage in each one of these life processes. So they have to do everything on the list to be a living thing. Can't even miss one of them. So when we look at nutrition is all about taking in food. It's a life process where food is taken in, or if you're a plant, where food is made. So nutrition is about eating. And we know that when we eat, we call the things that we eat, we call it food, and we know that food contains nutrients. And so some of the things that we might list as nutrients are things like carbohydrates, fats, proteins, fiber, vitamins, water. All of those things are considered nutrients because those are all materials that we need to take in for survival. I know some of you might be a little surprised to see water on that list, but if you think about it, that is a material that you have to take in for survival. All right. Let's look at these energy roles. Let's do a quick review here. So in an ecosystem, we have these basic energy roles that have to do with how does this organism obtain its nutrition? How does it get its nutrition? We know that we have the first one is producers. Those are, of course, mostly plants. Producers are organisms that make their own food. In addition, we have another energy role called consumers. These are organisms that consume things, meaning they eat other organisms for their food. Now, you may eat plants, you may eat animals, but you eat other organisms. You can't make your own food. Finally, we have something called decomposers. Decomposers feed on dead material. Now, I want to point out that decomposers are technically just another type of consumer, but they're important enough to where we want to make them their own group. So the three energy roles are producers that can make their own food, consumers that have to eat or other organisms, and then decomposers that break down. Show how an organism or tell how an organism gets the energy it needs for survival. How does it get its nutrition? So when we look at our types of consumers, we have three different types. We have, of course, carnivores. Those are animals that eat mostly only meat. We have herbivores. Those are animals that mostly only eat plant material. And then finally, omnivores are animals that eat both. Remember, plants make their own food. You won't find plants really on here that much. Some of you go, but wait, what about carnivorous plants like Venus flytraps? We're going to ignore some exceptions here because some of you may have also seen your cat, which is definitely a carnivore, eat grass. So we have to use these terms as generals. So food chains are when we look anytime we look at energy in an ecosystem, we need to think about a food chain. Now, this is something you've seen time and time again, where we have energy that enters from the sun, enters an ecosystem. It's collected via photosynthesis. By those producers. Here we have grass, and then we have something like an herbivore, an insect, which is a consumer that's going to eat that grass, which passes that energy. That energy now from the sun was passed to the grasshopper. But then, of course, the grasshopper is eaten. The grasshopper is eaten by, here we have a bluebird, and so that energy from the grass is now passed to the bluebird. And if the bluebird is eaten by the snake, that energy keeps getting passed. The thing that I need you to pay attention to is that that energy that was initially collected from the sun gets passed through the entire ecosystem. When we think about food chains, the first thing we think about is, but really this is about how energy moves. So it moves from organism to organism to organism, but always starting with the producer, because remember, all of our energy inside of an ecosystem comes from the sun. The second thing, and I know you guys look at this in fifth grade, is this is something called an energy pyramid. An energy pyramid shows us kind of who eats who, but it also gives us a bit more information. It shows us the amount of energy that's going to be available at a particular level of the pyramid. So down here at the base, we have all of our producers. So on an energy pyramid, the base is always going to be producers, and we can see that we're going to have a lot of producers down here. Okay, so if we have all of this grass, this is a lot of different organisms down here, a lot of different producers that are collecting energy from the sun. When an organism like rabbits eat that grass, most of the energy that they are going to take from that grass is going to be lost. Very little energy gets passed up. So they do take some of that energy that was collected, but a lot of it just simply gets lost. It is not used for cellular respiration. So we can have fewer rabbits, so a lot of producers, then we're going to have fewer consumers. And each time we move up and we pass energy, there's less and less energy that's going to be available. And as we move up, we'll find that there's less energy and fewer organisms. So in an ecosystem, we're of course going to have lots of producers. And then we're going to have, we're going to have herbivores. There's going to be quite a few of those. If you think about our local ecosystems, things like rabbits and squirrels, things that are strictly herbivores, there's generally more of those things. But as we move to snakes and then on up into some of these apex predators, we're going to, if you think about it, there's just fewer of these. And why does that happen? That's because there's just not as much energy, because so much energy ends up being lost as it's passed from consumer to consumer. Okay? All right, let's keep moving. So this is probably the most important slide that I can show you to have you think about the movement of energy and nutrients. So the first thing that I want to point out, let's take a look. So here we have the sun, photosynthesis. We have energy, which is, of course, going to be the, and use the yellow arrows here. We're going to have energy being converted into sugar, and then it's going to move to consumers, and then it can move here. It shows it moving to decomposers. And then it just notice how it stops here. Notice how, as we look at this energy from the sun, at each step, some is lost. But after it gets to decomposers, it doesn't go anywhere else. Let's compare that to nutrients here. So the nutrients start out here. This would be things, of course, like carbon dioxide, oxygen, water, carbon, lots of chemicals like that. So it starts out here with the producers. These nutrients or these chemicals get passed to the consumers. They then get passed to the decomposers. They then go back into the soil, and they get, once they're in the soil, they get passed back to the, so notice how this path is quite a bit different. We have a cycle here, but here we just have, when we look at our nutrients, we have them cycling, but when we look here and we're looking at our energy, eventually, poof, it's gone from the ecosystem. So let's look and see what that means. So when we talk about energy, it's appropriate to say that energy flows through ecosystems. That is quite a bit different than what we see happening with our nutrients. So nutrients, on the other hand, they're going to cycle within the ecosystem. So when we talk about energy flow, we're of course talking about that energy from the sun being collected by producers, stored in food, meaning glucose, using photosynthesis. That energy keeps getting passed to consumers, but we lose some. Those organisms are of course using that energy in the food, and when they do, when they release that energy, some of the heat is lost each time. And eventually, all of that energy that was sunlight and was turned into glucose is going to be lost as heat. That's why we say energy flows through ecosystems. And eventually, it flows out of an ecosystem back into outer space. Nutrients, on the other hand, those raw materials, are going to be cycled over and over again. Elements like carbon and oxygen, nitrogen and hydrogen, phosphorus, all of these materials get used over and over and over again. They're used in cellular respiration, they're used in photosynthesis, they're used in water for survival. All of those nutrients just keep moving through the ecosystem. All those atoms and molecules just keep moving through that ecosystem over and over and over again as they're passed from consumers to decomposers to producers and over again. Okay, so really our notes today are going to be really straightforward. They're going to be super simple. I just want you to remember, because this is a big deal, energy flows through ecosystems, whereas nutrients only get cycled within the ecosystem. They never leave. Energy will eventually flow to back out to space. So go ahead and copy this in your notebook, pause the video, And once you've got that done, I want you to restart your video. Okay, so here's our just for fun lab for today. And this is gonna seem a little strange at first, but I actually want you to keep a food journal. Now, a food journal is just you writing down in your science notebook a list of all the food that you eat in a day, okay? So it's, you know, start at the moment that you get up and just write down, what did you have for lunch? What did you have for a snack? What did you have for breakfast? You know, what did you have for dinner? Just include everything you eat, okay? Now, what we're looking to do is we wanna see if we can trace the energy that's in your food back to the sun for each food item. So here's my example. So this morning I had a bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit. Okay, so I had bacon this morning. Now I know that bacon comes from a pig. If that is news for you, I apologize for ruining bacon. So my question is really becomes, how did sunshine get in a pig? Now if I stop for a moment and I think about energy flow and ecosystems, I know that pigs are mostly herbivores that ate plants. And then the plants, I've got back to a plant now, the plant captured that sunlight using photosynthesis. Pow, okay, so I understand how a pig is connected. My bacon is connected to sunlight. Now, I will tell you, it's not always going to be that straightforward. To be successful, you're gonna have to understand some of the main ingredients in the food you're eating. So for example, my biscuit this morning, I know biscuits are made from flour, and the flour that I was using was a wheat flour. And so wheat flour, well, what even is wheat? What is that? So, you know, and I also have cheese. I mean, where does cheese come from? Where does American cheese come from? So I will tell you, you're going to have to look at those ingredients, and you may have to do a couple of quick Google searches. In just a moment, you should be able to find some relationships. You know, we're always looking to get back to, how is this connected to a plant, which is connected to photosynthesis and to that sunlight. So keep your food journal. And let's see if you can figure out how everything that you eat in one day, see if you can figure out how the energy you're going to take from it comes from the sunlight. Guys, that should do it for now. So until next time, stay curious.